At this time, please turn off all electronic devices. Also, if you need to exit, please use the exit doors to your left. Thank you and enjoy the show. Good evening, my name is Ginny. It is my pleasure to welcome you to the American Adventure. To preserve the dignity of our show, please silence all cell phones and refrain from video recording and flash photography. And now we proudly present the American Adventure.
America did not exist. Four centuries of work, bloodshed, loneliness, and fear created this land. We built America, and the process made us Americans. A new breed, rooted in all races, stained and tinted with all colors, a singing ethnic anarchy. Then, in a little time, we became more alike than we were different. A new society, not great, but fitted by our very faults for greatness. Excuse me, Mr. Twain.
What's that?
Perhaps you recognize those inspiring words from one of America's great writers.
No, Dr. Franklin, I don't recall writing anything like that.
Oh, my, of course not. They're from the pen of John Steinbeck, back in the 20th century. Why, it seems he has nearly the same spirit as the founding fathers themselves.
Well, listen to the proud elder statesman.
Mr. Twain, pride is one of our national passions. Even those who overcome it are proud of their humility.
Easy now. I was born modest. Fortunately, it wore off. Dr. Franklin is our genuine American antique. I suppose our story began with you.
Actually, it started long before even my time. It started when dreams and visions of a new world were shrouded in the myths and legends of an old world. Finally, through those early mists of uncertainty, sailed the first great adventurers. This tiny ship is the Mayflower, carrying pilgrims in search of their dream, a dream of religious freedom. So, if you'll pardon an old man's pride, for me, this is the beginning of the American Adventure.
There's a land across this ocean I'm waiting to see. A land for these people who dream to be free. So stand by the mainsail, the fierce storms will race. Aloft when he makes our King Neptune will face. You think that these landlubbers never would last. This cargo of pilgrims 12 weeks for the mast. It's land ho, me hearties, at last we've arrived. And praise be to God, nearly all have survived. But a look o'er this wilderness brings me to dread. Let the first bitter winter may leave all more dead. They call themselves pilgrims, these poor wretched souls, with a dream to be free in the new world their goal.
Yes, far from welcoming the early settlers, this land severely challenged them. It was a struggle for survival that gained but a tiny toehold in a vast, untamed wilderness. In the decades that followed, a new challenge began to emerge. We were growing more and more apart from the mother country. Passion began to govern, and she never governs wisely.
Policy is both arbitrary and unjust. That's nonsense. The same teeth that cost you 3 ships a pound cost us 6.
First, we spoke out with our voices. Then, we spoke out with action, with a growing defiance that led to the Boston Tea Party.
Finally, the time had come to speak with one voice in a declaration of independence.
Ah, good evening, Mr. Jefferson. Have you finished the new draft yet?
Those are new drafts all over the floor, Dr. Franklin. It seems one stroke of this pen brings 2 changes from Congress. I told you John Adams should have written this.
Oh, by his own admission, you can write circles around him.
Mr. Adams has not been prisoner in this loft for 17 days. I shall continue tomorrow.
You must continue now. Thomas, it is difficult to make 13 clocks chime at the same time, but we must carefully justify this separation.
Dr. Franklin, while you slept soundly through the meeting this afternoon, we did manage to justify separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted.
76, my boys, we ever must revere. Let every man take his musket up and fight for freedom dear. We'll dip the flags of the red for ranks as Yankee volunteers. Oh, tis a great delight to march and fight, but it's getting tough, I fear.
I shall spend another night of it.
At least, you got shoes, mate. There's not a dozen left what can say that.
Ah, don't tell me, friend. Tell the good general, then. Tell him that half his camp has got typhus, smallpox, or dysentery.
And there be not a ration amongst us. Now we can forage for hickory nuts.
Aye, while the English overindulge in our Philadelphia's fine food and drink.
It's a strange war we shoulder, George Washington. Congress sleeps warmly in York.
And the British party in Philadelphia.
And we freeze or starve to death here in Valley Forge.
The names of Valley Forge, my lords, forever we must hail. We fight the cold with rags on our feet as the lobster bands regale. But the time will come when they'll be on the run and their ships will homeward sail. Oh, it's a great delight to march and fight along the victory trail. It's a great delight to march and fight along the victory trail.
In the end, we the people prevail and achieve perhaps our greatest dream. 13 very different colonies became the United States of America, and we were free to become an entire nation of dreamers and doers.
Westward bound, Dr. Franklin, to new frontiers.
To the age of Samuel Langhorne Clemens.
Well, I like to think Mark Twain was part of all that.
You founding fathers gave us a pretty good start, don't you know? We still had some things to learn the hard way. Seems a whole bunch of folks found out we the people didn't yet mean all the people. Folks like Frederick Douglass.
Even amidst the crowd of cricket song here along Mark Twain's beloved Mississippi. I hear the noise of chains and the crack of the whip. And yet, there is hope. Hope born from the words of Harriet Beecher Stowe. Uncle Tom's Cabin has given our nation a key which can unlock the slave prison to millions. Anti-slavery is no longer a thing to be prevented. It is grown too abundant to be stuffed out like a lantern.
Troublemakers like Douglas got us into this mess.
We only wanted freedom, not war.
Well, listen to my abolitionist brother.
What?
Pa, he's gonna make a real good Philly Yank.
We got a good cause, Johnny Reb.
Quiet, both of you. You're gonna ruin Ma's birthday.
No, no. Ain't nothing gonna ruin today. We're all together. That's what counts. Now, you go ahead, Mr. Brady.
All right, everybody. Oh, real still now.
Two brothers on their way, two brothers on their way, two brothers on their way, one wore blue and one wore gray. One wore blue and one wore gray as they marched along their way. The fife and drum began to play, all on a beautiful morning. One was gentle, one was kind. One was gentle, one was kind. One came home, one stayed behind. A cannonball, don't pay no mind. Don't pay no mind if you're gentle or if you're kind. It don't think of the folks behind, all on a beautiful morning.
Franklin's Philadelphia again. We're 100 years old today. We came a long way in that first century. But like Susan B. Anthony, we're still speaking out.
And why shouldn't we, Mr. Twain?
As Tom Edison says, discontent is the first necessity of progress.
Edison? Afraid I don't place a name.
Edison's that young phonograph inventor. Why, this great hall is filled with new inventions. There's Otis Elevator, Cora's magnificent steam engines.
And don't forget me telephone, the true hallmark of progress.
Aha! Behold the proud Scots.
That's right. Carnegie Steel built this place.
Aye, and it'll soon build a new concert hall for New York.
Oh, Carnegie Hall, eh? It'll never last. Donating libraries. Andy, that's a grand idea.
'Tis an age for grand ideas.
An era for innovation.
A dawn for new awareness.
A time to challenge the frontiers of a new century.
Beautiful. Bully beautiful. Those falls are magnificent.
Aye, Mr. President. But it won't last if the timber thieves have their way.
John, you may be right, but the country's growth is putting a tremendous demand on our resources.
Any fool can destroy trees. Why, for more than 3,000 years, God has cared for our giant sequoias, saved them from drought, disease, avalanches, and floods. But he cannot save them from fools.
Now, John, you know I can't ask lumbering to stop completely.
All I ask is that we stop massive destruction. What will our children inherit? Seedlings?
Of course not. I realize we're not building this country for a generation alone. I know we've got to expand our parks.
Then start it here and now. Make this valley a part of Yosemite National Park.
Well, I guess we needed those national parks. Seems the simple life of my day was slipping away. But ready or not, we were soon thrust into the hectic role of a world leader and into the war to end all wars.
Non-stop hours after his departure from New York, Captain Charles Augustus Lindbergh successfully landed his Spirit of St. Louis in Paris last week. Lucky Lindy's solo flight across the Atlantic has certainly placed him among the greatest in a long line of American pioneers.
Today, October 29, 1929, Wall Street became America's greatest wall of rubble. This stock market crash has tarnished the golden dreams of millions.
Once I built a tower to the sun, brick and rivet and mine. Once I built a tower, now it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime?
Spare a dime? Sure. Buy four of my apples, and I'll loan you back to 10 cents.
Hey, Sam, I heard tell there's New York millionaires selling apples, too.
You mean ex-millionaires, don't you?
Hey, looks like the storm is finally letting up. Well, maybe the Sunday drivers will come out hunting for gas.
Ain't many folks will pay no 18 cents a gallon.
Hey, listen, fellas, the whole FDR's been inaugurated.
No truth, frankly, and boldly. This great nation will endure as it has endured, will revive, and will prosper. So first of all, let me assert my firm belief that the only thing we have to fear is fear itself.
So hope he's right. Folks could use a little prosperity around these parts.
Yes, sir. Before this depression, we sure had enjoyed special blessings.
Hold it.
But you I think it seems to be that we was a mighty happy nation. We begun to believe that the height of civilization was an automobile, a radio, and a bathtub. Of course, now we're a whole lot smarter. Now, Congress wants to trim down the Navy so it'll fit into the bathtub, too. You know, it seems to me like we're the only nation in the world that waits till we get in the war before we start getting ready for it.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a big of the
down, Eagle. Tranquility base here. The Eagle has landed. Well, Mr. Twain, what do you think of our America now?
I think the Founding Fathers never dreamed of an America like this.
Of course not. We weren't dreamers. We were visionaries. That is why our Constitution withstands the rigors of time.
Easy now, Dr. Franklin. This nation is still just a youngster, don't you know? Why, some countries have been around for 50 centuries. We're barely in our third.
That's true. But look what we've accomplished in that tiny span of time.
My dear doctor, earlier you found John Steinbeck so inspiring. But he also sounded this warning. We now face the danger which in the past has been the most destructive to the human. Success, plenty, comfort, and ever-increasing leisure. No dynamic people has ever survived these dangers.
I may have invented these bifocals I'm wearing, but I can assure you they are not rose-colored. Mr. Twain, the golden age never was the present age, but with human liberty, we can fulfill the promise and meaning of America. To everyone a chance, believe Thomas Wolfe. To all people, regardless of their birth, right to live, to work, to be themselves, and to become whatever their visions can combine to make them. This is the promise of America. Mr. Twain, it is easy to see, hard to foresee, but I foresee the American adventure to continue a long, long time.